kind of the way I jump into styles would be ales and lagers, which is differentiated by the type of yeast, ales being top fermenting and lagers being bottom fermenting. The mass-produced yellow fizzy beers, as a lot of people like to call them, are most often lagers because they have more neutral flavor profiles. They are much more, we'll say, controllable, or in a macro setting, they create a lot less headaches. And so the lagers, while they're, I wouldn't consider them inferior yeast, do have a much more predictable and consistent flavor profile. And then you would move to the other side of the fence would be ales or top fermenting, where you get your stouts, your porters, IPAs, Belgian beers, and those would kind of be the main breaks of styles as you would go to there. But then you would have also wild and spontaneously fermenting yeasts that now, in, with modern technology, have been so isolated and actually stand in a different genus and species than the yeast that make up ales and lagers. You know, in some senses, I do like making the same beers over and over again because you get to really figure out what makes a difference. And so, like, on a day-to-day basis, you know, probably the light blonde ales and things are fun to do. In a more private setting, probably the wild and sour beers are really fun because you kind of have to coax those yeasts a little bit, and you kind of do this dance with it. And sometimes the dance is great, and sometimes it's like, well, let's save it for another day. You feel much more a part of, like, this sort of symbiosis when you get into the wild and sour beers, because you can feed them different things, you can age them in different barrels or in different vessels, and that all kind of plays into it. So probably sort of the closest to my heart would be the sour and wild beers because they don't create the most predictable results, and I kind of like the idea of vintages in wine, whereas these would be vintages in dealing with these kinds of yeast.